I tried to keep my remarks within the allotted time today, although I hope you'll remember the famous words of my favorite theologian, Tallulah Bankhead, who said, "Too much of a good thing is wonderful." I am going to be watching the time myself, but it also reminds me of the story of the two young boys, one Baptist, one Catholic, and the Baptist went to his Catholic friend's church one Sunday, and the Catholic kid explained the statues of the saints, the stained glass windows, the things the priest was doing at the altar. And the next week, the Catholic went to the Baptist boy's church, and the first thing the preacher did when he got in the pulpit was take off his watch and put it on the pulpit. And so the Catholic said to his Baptist buddy, "What does that mean?" And the Baptist said, "That doesn't mean a damn thing." As Shaylin said, and I'm grateful for her introduction, University of Alabama Press published my book, Bishops, Bourbons, and Big Mules, A History of the Episcopal Church in Alabama. But since I'm in Montgomery, I wanted to focus my remarks on things apropos to the city of Montgomery. Fortunately, that's easy to do. My knowledge of the history of Montgomery is pretty superficial, but I will claim to have a thorough acquaintance with the history of the Episcopal Church in our state. And to speak of the Episcopal Church in Alabama, one has to speak of the Episcopal Church in Montgomery. The title of my talk and the title of my book also alludes to my thesis. The Episcopal Church, as its name suggests, is a church of bishops. Episkopos, the Greek word translated as overseer or supervisor, came to be applied to bishops, chief pastors of the early church. So we are a church of episcopoi, bishops. Bourbon, of course, is the name of the Royal House of France, but it also came to be applied to the plantation aristocracy in the South after Reconstruction. It was said that as the Royal House of France returned to power after the Revolution, so the planter aristocrats returned to power after Reconstruction. And Governor Bibb Graves applied the title Big Mules to Alabama's industrialists. So my argument is that the Episcopal Church in Alabama and Montgomery was, at least until World War II and maybe later, the church of the planter aristocracy and also the church of the industrialist. The history of the Episcopal Church, and indeed the history of any church, is never just a history of bishops, priests, and parish buildings or churches. It is primarily a history of all those who bear the name Christian, and there are far more lay people who bear that name than clergy. It is also a history of how the church responded to the great movements of history and how the great movements of history influenced the church. The authors of a book entitled The Power of Their Glory state that the Episcopal Church was the cause of great opportunity in the United States, the foundation of public service, of a massive tradition of private support, of irreplaceable public institutions, the root of much that was best in political thought and practice. To a large degree, the Episcopal Church, like it or not, produced America. So there's also a sense in which the Episcopal Church produced Alabama. Although the Episcopal Church is small in numbers, it is great in influence, or at least in claiming among its members those who are socially, politically, and economically influential. For most of its history in Alabama, the membership of the Episcopal Church has been just under 1% of the state's population. But if you look at any significant group of leaders, governors, congressmen, or senators, you'll find that in many cases, 10% of them are Episcopalians. To choose an especially appropriate example from Montgomery, 4 of our 20th century governors were Episcopalians, and together they governed for 20 years, or 20% of the 20th century. So that's greatly in excess of our numbers. Our numbers are under report our actual influence in the state. The first two Episcopal churches in Alabama were in Tuscaloosa and in Mobile, both founded in February of 1828, within weeks of each other. Although technically not in the Black Belt, Tuscaloosa is close to the northwest tip of the Black Belt, and its position on the Black Warrior River makes it ideal for transportation and shipping. The economy of Alabama's port city, Mobile, was dependent on the cotton plantations of the Black Belt, and the planters were dependent upon the cotton factors and merchants of Mobile. Most of the earliest Episcopal churches in Alabama were in the Black Belt. The 1844 convention that elected Nicholas Hamner Cobbs as the first bishop of the Episcopal Diocese of Alabama was held at St. Paul's Greensboro, and the only churches present at that convention to elect Bishop Cobbs were Black Belt churches, with the exception of Christ Church Mobile, and as I've said, its economy was dependent on the Black Belt. But today our concern is only with the Episcopal churches in Montgomery. I'll be talking about eight topics: the beginnings of the Episcopal Church in Alabama, the Civil War, Reconstruction, Edgar Gardner Murphy, former rector of St. John's Montgomery, and his application of the social gospel, a new century, the civil rights era, the latter part of the 20th century, and a conclusion. Before 1829, Montgomery's Protestants worshiped together in a so-called Union Church that included Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterians, and Episcopalians. Between 1829 and 1830, these different denominational groups began to withdraw from the Union Church and build their own buildings. When I was writing my book, I did a good deal of research on visitors to Alabama in the 19th century. Two of the most interesting were the Hungarian nationalist and sometime revolutionary Ferenc Polsky and his wife Teresa. They visited Montgomery in the late 1840s, and they reported, "When we came near to Montgomery, the high bluffs on the banks disappeared. The river runs here through an undulating country. Houses were scattered along the banks. A crowd was assembled along the landing place. Guns were fired. Gentlemen displayed their horsemanship. Carriages and committees awaited us to take us to the city, but the shooting and cheering and reports of cannons frightened the horses. I was glad when we were safely lodged in the Exchange Hotel." St. John's was founded in 1834, and its first rector was the Reverend William Johnson of Beaufort, South Carolina. Little is known about the first building that St. John's occupied, but more significant was the decision 17 years later to build a grand new church that we see today. So a little background is in order. This is Trinity Mobile, and when it was built or rebuilt in 1853, New York architects Henry Dudley and Frank Wills were selected as the architects. And this was a very significant decision because Wills and Dudley were the foremost exponents in America of Gothic architecture, or neo-Gothic architecture. Dudley was a founder of the New York Ecclesiological Society, an organization inspired by the ideals of English architect Augustus Pugin, who assisted in the design of the Houses of Parliament, or Palace of Westminster. Frank Wills wrote, "There's a, quote, Catholicity in architecture as well as the church that could be separated from popery as well in one as in the other. For him, quote, Christianity laid the broad foundations of its lengthened aisles, bade arch soar above arch and all point up to heaven. The church, the physical church, the building, should bid those who cross its threshold to humble himself to the dust and be awed into adoration and prostrate himself before his God." In other words, Will says, a Christian will understand the church owes its shape as well as its existence to his creed. So Trinity Mobile set off something of a craze for Gothic architecture in Alabama. Wills and Dudley also designed St. John's Montgomery and Nativity in Huntsville. Here we have Nativity, and finally St. John's Montgomery. About the same time that Trinity, Nativity, and St. John's were built, the diocese also elected its first bishop, Nicholas Hamner Cobbs. Cobbs embraced a new movement that had swept the Church of England and then deeply influenced the Episcopal Church in the United States, what we call the Oxford Movement, or Anglo-Catholic, or High Church Movement. The Oxford Movement emphasized the Catholic with a small c roots of Anglicanism. At first, it was primarily concerned with doctrine, but soon this concern with small c Catholic doctrine influenced an interest in love of Gothic or neo-Gothic architecture. So the choice of Wills and Dudley to design three of Alabama's most prominent Episcopal churches sheds light on the choice of Cobbs to be the first bishop of this diocese. The decision to favor Gothic architecture strongly suggests that the clergy of Alabama, and perhaps the lay people as well, already leaned in the direction of the Oxford movement, or the so-called high church position, because this was Cobbs's position. He was a high churchman. Cobbs logically chose to live in Tuscaloosa. It was not only the capital of Alabama, but was also strategically located on the Black Warrior River. Then a principal north-south waterway, Cobbs could travel downriver to visit churches in Greensboro, Demopolis, and Mobile, and then he could travel back upriver on the Alabama River to visit Selma and Montgomery. Some of the time that Cobbs lived in Alabama, he also served as rector of Christ Church, Tuscaloosa. But in 1854, Cobbs accepted the invitation of St. John's Montgomery to become their rector, a logical move again because by 1846, the capital of Alabama had moved to Montgomery. A native of Virginia, Bishop Cobbs grew up in a slave state and owned slaves himself. But in 1843, he was called as rector of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Cincinnati. And since Ohio was a free state, he freed his slaves before moving to Cincinnati. Although the slave censuses of 1850 and 1860 show that after he moved to Alabama, he once again acquired slaves and had them both in Tuscaloosa and Montgomery. Although Cobbs was no abolitionist, he was opposed to secession, strongly opposed to it. He loved the Union. In 1859, when the threat of secession and war was on the horizon, Cobbs wrote to Henry Lay, rector of Nativity Huntsville, and one of his closest friends. Indeed, Cobbs regarded Lay almost as a son and as a protege. He wrote saying, "The worldliness that is rushing upon us like a flood, what is to be done or turn it aside? Almost every day we have fresh and mortifying instances of its extent and influence. I'm sometimes almost out of heart, and I feel tempted to put on a long cassock of black, tied with a thick rope, and go forth with a long staff mounted with a cross, proclaiming day by day in the churches and by the wayside. In this way the people might be startled, and perchance some might be induced to remember that they had souls to care for." And I think, although he doesn't talk about secession, secession is what was on his mind. In spite of Cobb's opposition to secession, when he became rector of St. John's in Montgomery, he was faced with a church in which there were strongly differing opinions about staying with the Union or seceding. But he managed to hold them together. There's a wonderful document in the archives at St. John's Montgomery. I hope those of you from St. John's know of this. It's the reminiscences of Charles T. Pollard, who was senior warden or the chief lay official of the church for much of the 19th century. And Pollard said that the 6 years while Bishop Cobbs served as rector were years of political confusion, and but for the bishop's wise and serene influence, St. John's would probably have been divided into two factions, followers of Hilliard, who was a Unionist congressman, or followers of Yancey, who had been a congressman for one term, in fact, a contemporary of Abraham Lincoln. But Yancey did everything in his power to foment secession. The story of Bishop Cobb's death is well known, but it bears repeating. His last visit as bishop was to St. Matthew's Otagaville on October 21, 1860, and sometime after that he seems to have suffered a stroke and then was confined to his bed until he died. Later it was said that Bishop Cobbs prayed that he would not see the Union divide, and if so, his prayers were answered because he died on January 11, 1861. The day that the Alabama seceded from the Union, and said he died just before the noon gun fired to announce that the secession vote had been taken. He was followed at St. John's as rector by his assistant, John Mitchell. And Mitchell wrote this letter to Henry C. Lay about the bishop's death, saying, "I thought I knew how good and holy he was before, but I did not until I was much with him during his last illness. He suffered from nausea and vomiting, how intensely no one can describe, and yet not a murmur or other sign of impatience from the beginning to end. On the contrary, his most fervent exclamation was, 'I thank God for this sickness.' nor did he manifest at any time the slightest fear of death. He suffered less the last 3 days, retained his consciousness up to the hour before he died, and finally fell asleep as gently as a child falls asleep in the arms of its mother. Mitchell was also aware that the diocese had been deprived of Cobb's leadership precisely at the moment that they most needed it. He wrote to Lay, "It is a sad, sad time for our country to have lost such a man and our church such a bishop." With the coming of the Civil War, St. John's became a virtual chapel for the Confederate leadership during the short time that the Confederate capital was here in Montgomery. Vermont native J. Avery Shepherd, who served as head of Hamner Hall Female Seminary, a school that Cobbs helped to found, not only gave the invocation for the Confederate Congress on the day that Jefferson Davis was inaugurated, Shepherd also served as chair of the truce committee that surrendered Montgomery to federal forces in April of 1865. I think there's some irony in that, don't you? During the week prior to the surrender, Shepherd spent most of his time attempting to persuade his friends and acquaintances to receive federal forces with civility. And he was successful in this because a member of the general staff stayed in Shepherd's home. Nowhere in the entire South, they said, had they been received with more courtesy than Montgomery. From the beginning of the occupation, Shepherd was given a military escort, and the general and his staff were often his guests for both dinner and breakfast. Again, Charles Pollard from St. John's wrote about the period of the Civil War. "In the hour that Alabama seceded, all the differences of opinion among the people of Montgomery disappeared. We became one in preparing for war. No spot in the city felt more keenly the impact of war than did St. John's, for here events moved rapidly. St. John's seemed to be the heart of the Confederacy. President Davis and his family, most of the cabinet members and their families, staff officers from time to time, all came to St. John's, for all of us knew that this was a time for prayer. All the young men left in uniform. The church was open for prayer at all times. The vestry and nearby rectory overflowed with busy women making uniforms, knitting, cooking, and scraping lint for bandages." And as he said, Jefferson Davis and his wife, Verena, worshiped in St. John's. William Howard Russell, the war correspondent for the Times of London, visited Montgomery a few weeks before the beginning of the war, but did not have very flattering things to say about the capital. He said, "Montgomery has little claim to be called a capital. The streets are hot, pleasant, and uninteresting. I have rarely seen a more dull, lifeless place. It looks like a small Russian town in the interior." And he knew about that. He'd also covered the Crimean War. It's also worth quoting the observation he made about the institution of slavery as he looked out over the fields from the windows of the Capitol building. Russell wrote, "As I stood at the upper window of the Capitol and looked on the wide expanse of richly wooded, well-cultivated land which sweeps round the hill to the horizon, I could not help thinking of the misery and cruelty which must have been born in tilling the land and raising the houses and streets of the dominant race before whom one nationality of colored people has perished within the memory of man. The misery and cruelty of the system are established by the advertisements for runaway Negroes and by the description of the stigmata on their persons, whippings and brandings, scars and cuts." Montgomery not only served as the birthplace of the Confederacy, it also served as the place where the Confederate Episcopal Church was organized. In response to a letter from Bishops Leonidas Polk of Louisiana and Stephen Elliott of Georgia, they suggested that the bishops of the Confederate states meet in Montgomery to organize a separate church from the Episcopal Church of the United States. The meeting was held in Montgomery in July of 1861, in spite of the fact that some bishops warned it would not be well attended, and they proved to be correct. Only four bishops attended the first meeting, which was held at St. John's. So they adjourned and reconvened later that fall in Columbia, South Carolina, at which time the Confederate Episcopal Church was organized. And sometimes it is said that the Episcopal Church was the only church that did not divide during the Civil War. This is not correct. The Episcopal Church in the Confederate States was organized as a separate and independent church of the Episcopal Church. And at the end of the war, there was question about whether or not the two groups would be reunited. And indeed, Bishop of Wilmer of Alabama was opposed to it. 2 months later, St. John's also hosted Kevin? It's not running. 2 months earlier, St. John's had also hosted the 1861 convention of the Diocese of Alabama that attempted to elect a second bishop for Alabama but failed to do so. Then a special convention was held at St. Paul's Selma in November of 1861, and they succeeded in electing another Virginian as Bishop of Alabama, Richard Hooker Wilmer, the only bishop elected and consecrated in the Confederate Episcopal Church, so that after the Civil War, he had to be received by the Episcopal Church as though coming from another communion. Thank you. Great. Toward the end of the war, there was an attempt to build a church. Before I go on, that is a marvelous picture of Bishop Wilmer. Most of the pictures you see are of him at a very advanced age. This is the only one I've seen, and it's in my book, of Wilmer as a young man. I suspect this is about the time he was elected and consecrated Bishop of Alabama, although I'm not sure. Toward the end of the war, there was an attempt to build a church in memory of Bishop Cobbs. In 1864, the Church of the Holy Comforter was organized by a group of refugees from Pensacola and admitted to the diocese. The original intention was to call it the Memorial Church in memory and in honor of Bishop Cobbs, but John Mitchell, the rector of St. John's, objected, and Bishop Wilmer proposed changing the name to Holy Comforter. Wilmer served as Bishop of Alabama for 39 years. I think that's still the record in the Episcopal Church for the longest service as a bishop. After the war, Wilmer precipitated a serious crisis when he instructed his clergy not to pray for the President of the United States. Wilmer was an arch Confederate, and I have no doubt that he issued this instruction because of his animosity toward the North. But he justified doing so by saying that Alabama was under military rule, not civil rule. And he said, when civil authority shall be restored, it will be eminently proper for the church to resume that prayer. The military governor of Alabama was Major General George H. Thomas, who, like Wilmer, was a Virginian. Walter Whitaker tells us that Wilmer had been all through the war, characterized him as a renegade. This characterization was not confined to the Bishop of Alabama, but in Wilmer's hand, it was especially caustic. Wilmer was well known as a wit, sometimes a very biting wit. Thomas directed his subordinate, Major General Charles Woods, to investigate the matter of the bishop's instructions to the clergy, and Woods responded by issuing General Orders Number 38, in which he characterized Wilmer as having, quote, a factious and disloyal spirit, as being an unsafe teacher not to be trusted in places of power or influence over public opinion. I have to agree with him. The general then ordered Alabama's Episcopal churches closed and forbade Wilmer and his clergy to preach or perform divine service until such a time as said bishop and clergy show a sincere return to their allegiance of the government of the United States and give evidence of a loyal and patriotic spirit by offering to resume the use of the prayer for the president and all in civil authority and by taking the amnesty oath prescribed by the president. Woods' orders were widely disobeyed. He had forbidden the clergy to preach or perform divine service, but I think this was interpreted simply to have the churches closed, and they were closed for a year. If Bishop Wilmer's schedule is any indication, the clergy continued to function in private homes and other places. According to the bishop's journal, he preached, celebrated the Eucharist, even married a couple while the military order was in effect. In at least one case, however, the authorities intervened to prevent a service from taking place. In a letter dated December 12, 1865, and addressed to the provisional governor of Alabama, Montgomery physician and St. John's vestryman R.F. Michael or Mitchell noted that the principal of Hamner Hall invited the rector of St. John's to hold services there. Michael further noted that Hamner Hall was the residence of the principal's family and is under his control as if it were private property. But when the priest and members of the congregation arrived, they were met by a military official who forbade them to assemble. And although Michael doesn't mention it, doesn't mention the use of force, again, Charles Pollard charged that a detachment of soldiers entered the school with fixed bayonets and drove us out. Finally, President Andrew Johnson directed General Thomas to withdraw his order. He grudgingly obeyed and withdrew his ban, issuing a retraction, General Orders Number 40. Thomas again referred to Wilmer as an individual styling himself the Bishop of Alabama. and said that he had forgotten his mission to preach peace on earth and goodwill towards men, and promoted a treasonable course from behind the shield of his office. Edgar Gardner Murphy in the Social Gospel. How many of you know Edgar Gardner Murphy? Oh my goodness. He was rector of St. John's, Montgomery, from 1898 to 1901. I think one of the most significant priests who's served in the Diocese of Alabama. He was passionately concerned with race relations, child labor, and education. Deeply concerned about the plight of the children who worked in the mills on Montgomery's west side, Murphy helped found Neighborhood House, which was a kind of settlement house such as was found in northern cities at that time. He was also instrumental in founding Montgomery's third Episcopal church, Church of the Good Shepherd. It was not only the third Episcopal church in Montgomery, it was also the third African-American church in the diocese, the first being Good Shepherd Mobile, the second St. Mark's Birmingham, and the third Good Shepherd Montgomery. That Murphy took the initiative to organize a church for African-Americans seems to be noble and progressive, but there is another side to the story. The result of organizing a black church in Montgomery had the effect of pulling the few remaining black worshipers out of the city's white churches into their own separate, that is, segregated congregation. It's true that in segregated churches, blacks could take leadership positions that weren't available to them in white churches, but the current members of Good Shepherd told me a tradition handed down there that Murphy's purpose in organizing Good Shepherd was to exclude them from St. John's. In many ways, Murphy exemplified the white liberal Southerner. He genuinely wanted to help black people, but was unable to imagine a day when blacks and whites could live and work together as equals. He took segregation for granted and saw no need to end it. The most troubling thing Murphy did in the area of race relations was to organize the Montgomery Conference on Race in 1900. Although urged by his friend Booker T. Washington to include some speakers who would speak in favor of civil rights for African Americans, the speakers Murphy invited were almost unanimous in their opposition to civil rights. Only one speaker, former West Virginia Governor William McCorkle, defended black enfranchisement, or giving votes to African Americans. One of the best characterizations of the Montgomery Conference was by a writer in a black newspaper in Washington, D.C., The Colored American, who said that it was, quote, a gathering of Pharisees who continually thanked God they were not as other men. Booker Washington came to regret his involvement with the conference 6 months after it. He wrote, there was not a single one of the conference's speakers, all white, quote, who did not lay special stress upon the superiority of his own race and the weaknesses of other races. Murphy even described his own position as white supremacy. The maintenance of white supremacy, he said, is an end with which I have been in earnest and positive sympathy, although he defined white supremacy as the supremacy of intelligence, administrative capacity, and public order. It means the perpetuation of those economic and civic conditions upon which the progress of the Negro is dependent. Booker T. Washington famously dined with Theodore Roosevelt and his wife and daughter at the White House. If you watch PBS's wonderful series on the Roosevelts, they tell this story. The Southern press exploded in outrage after Roosevelt dined with Washington. And even Murphy criticized him. He wrote him, quote, the average man in the street can see nothing in the incident but a deliberate attempt on the part of Roosevelt and yourself to force the issue of intermarriage and amalgamation. Hard to imagine. But in the area of child labor, Murphy's accomplishments were really substantial and progressive. He personally visited factories to compile statistics and anecdotes for his campaign against child labor, observing a girl of 7 who had lost 3 fingers in an industrial accident, a girl of 7. He asked the factory foreman what had happened. The foreman replied, well, children aren't just careless. Murphy commented, my God, hasn't a child 7 years old the right to be careless? After years of work, he was largely responsible for legislation passed by the Alabama legislature in 1907 prohibiting the employment of children under 12 years of age, limiting the hours of children from the age of 12 to 18, and requiring school for children under the age of 16. President Theodore Roosevelt corresponded with Murphy on the topic of child labor and regarded him as one of the country's most outstanding experts on the topic. A new century We'll look at Zelda and Tallulah, the Church of the Ascension, who will rid us of this troublesome bishop in responding to war. Zelda Sayre Fitzgerald was born in July 1900 and baptized at the Church of Holy Comforter in Montgomery. Along with her husband, novelist F. Scott Fitzgerald, the two of them practically defined the jazz age in America. Although Tallulah Bankhead was not a Montgomeryan, she had a connection with it. She and her sister Eugenia lived mainly with their grandparents when Congress was not in session. The rest of the time, they lived with their aunt Marie Bankhead Owen and Thomas McAdory Owen, associated with this building. Although her father, William Bankhead, Speaker of the House of Representatives from 1936 to 1940, was a Methodist, her mother had been an Episcopalian, and Congressman Bankhead fulfilled his late wife's wishes and raised Tallulah as an Episcopalian. In her autobiography, Tallulah wrote that she went to services at, quote, the little Episcopal chapel set up in a loft over a seed store in Jasper. Congressman Bankhead also gave his daughter the Bible that had belonged to his wife, and on the inside cover he wrote, quote, as a spiritual source at the end of each day, may I recommend to you your mother's favorite Psalm 103. Tallulah recalled, quote, I have never gone to church since I could avoid it without penalty, but I have found consolation in that psalm. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities, for he knoweth our frame and remembereth that we are but dust. In 1909, Montgomery Episcopalians organized the Church of the Ascension in Montgomery's Cloverdale neighborhood. The church's architect was Ralph Adams Cram, the successor to Wills and Dudley, an exponent of Gothic. He was the designer of many significant churches, most famously the Church of St. John the Divine, or Cathedral St. John the Divine in New York. In 1903, the Diocese of Alabama elected its fourth bishop, Charles Minigerode Beckwith. I don't have a picture of him. He proved to be not a good choice. He antagonized everyone he came into contact with, especially at the larger, wealthier urban churches, and the priest, I think, probably came to hate him. When he ordered Frederick Duvall, the rector of the Church of the Ascension, to stop having the choir bow to the altar during the procession and allowing laymen vested as acolytes into the chancel area during communion, Duvall said that in good conscience he could not obey Bishop Beckwith, and the bishop then brought charges against Duvall in ecclesiastical court, but the court refused to try the case. Another controversy erupted when Richard Wilkinson, rector of St. John's, invited Rabbi William Schwartz to lecture on the Jewish understanding of Jesus. Beckwith told Wilkinson he could not have the rabbi speak in the church. So Wilkinson had the rabbi speak in a Sunday school room. I was telling this story to a rabbi, you know, and he said, that was a good Talmudic interpretation. Beckwith brought charges against Wilkinson, but the court found in favor of the priest, not the bishop. And Beckwith rightly regarded this as a vote of no confidence. And when William McDowell was elected bishop in 1922, Beckwith turned over all authority to him. He remained in the office of Bishop of Alabama until his death in 1928, but never again meddled in the affairs of the diocese. He left that to McDowell. Episcopalians continued to occupy powerful and prominent offices in Alabama. Episcopalian Charles Henderson of Troy became Alabama's 35th governor in 1915, Alabama's 36th governor, and was also an Episcopalian, Thomas Kilby of Anniston. Because of its proximity to what was then called Camp Sheridan, St. John's, Montgomery rallied during World War I. The women of the church held open houses on Sunday afternoons and served in the Red Cross and also taught literacy classes for poorly educated soldiers. They performed a similar function during the Second World War. On Saturday afternoon, St. John's, Montgomery held open houses for the British cadets who were stationed at Maxwell Field. The Civil Rights Era. A momentous period in the history of Alabama and the U.S. began in December 1955 when black seamstress Rosa Parks defied legally mandated segregation and refused to yield her seat to a white passenger on a Montgomery City bus. The Reverend Thomas Thrasher, rector of the Church of the Ascension, played a small but significant part in the boycott. He was called as rector of Ascension in 1947, and he signaled he would be a different kind of rector when he asked the vestry if they would allow Ascension to host a meeting of the Southern Regional Conference, a fledgling civil rights organization that included both black and white members. The vestry refused to allow it, saying it would be better if the church were not used for the purpose mentioned. Racial tension also seems to be behind a request that Bishop Carpenter relocate or at least reschedule the youth convention scheduled for Ascension 1959. A member of the church had written the bishop a letter in 1956 objecting to, quote, mixing with the colored race as we have been at some conventions and conferences. In his book, Stride Toward Freedom, Dr. King's account of the boycott, he says that he got to know Father Thrasher through their mutual involvement in the Alabama Council of Human Relations, another civil rights organization. During the boycott, Thrasher arranged for members of the Montgomery Improvement Association to meet with city leaders. Thrasher's position on civil rights was unpopular with many members of the Ascension. Julian McPhillips, who served as curator assistant under Mark Waldo, the next rector, wrote, quote, "The Ascension membership was not ready for this, nor could they accept it. With a few noticeable exceptions, most of the people turned against Tom." But the critical turning point came in May of 1959 when Thrasher administered communion to a black priest at a service. I think the priest was Robert DuBose at that time. He was in charge of Good Shepherd Montgomery. In reaction, the vestry passed a resolution asserting that Ascension was, quote, a racially segregated congregation, end quote. Thatcher wrote Bishop Carpenter claiming that the motion originally proposed in the vestry was just that people be stationed at the doors of the church to politely but firmly tell any Negroes where they came, where they could find the Church of the Good Shepherd. The historian who wrote the history of the Ascension says, from that point onward, Mr. Thatcher found his initiatives blocked. Finally, in 1960, he accepted a call to Chapel of the Cross in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Another white Episcopalian who played a constructive role in the boycott was Juliet Hampton Morgan. She was also a member of the Ascension, the daughter of a prominent Montgomery couple. Morgan received a master's degree in English from the University of Alabama in 1935 and stayed on there to teach until 1938. Then she returned to Montgomery, teaching at Lanier High School for a while, and finally became the reference librarian at the Montgomery Public Library, which I understand is named after her today. As early as 1952, Morgan was publicly opposed to racial discrimination. She wrote a letter to the Montgomery Advertiser saying, "Our Lord is against us if we consent to discrimination by color or place of ancestry." And she was outspoken in her support of the boycott, writing another letter saying, "I find it hard to work up sympathy for the bus company. I've ridden the buses in Montgomery ever since they've been running, and I've heard some bus drivers use the tone and manner of mule drivers in their treatment of black passengers." In 1957, the editor of the Tuscaloosa News, Buford Boone, denounced racism in a speech before the White Citizens Council of Tuscaloosa. And Morgan wrote him a letter congratulating him, saying, "I'd begun to wonder if there were any men in the state, white men that is, with a sane evaluation of our situation, or with any goodwill, and especially any moral courage to express it." Her letter was supposed to be private, but it came to be published. And the library board responded, dismissing her from her position. She was then treated by a Birmingham psychiatrist, unfortunately not successfully, and she took her life in July 1957. When Episcopal seminarian Jonathan Daniels was shot and killed in Hainville in 1965, Charles Douglas, the rector of St. John's Montgomery, heard about it on the 6 o'clock news. I think he was possibly the first priest to learn of it, and he was the first priest to respond to it. The news erroneously identified Daniels as, quote, an Episcopal priest from New Haven, Connecticut. Douglas wrote a letter to Bishop Carpenter saying that he contacted the local funeral home when he learned of the killing to see if Daniels' body had been brought to Montgomery. He discovered that it had and went there. He was able to identify Daniels correctly by his VMI ring, which had his name and his place of birth on at Keene, New Hampshire. So he tried to contact the Bishop of New Hampshire. Failing that, he contacted the head of the Standing Committee in New Hampshire, and through him, he came in contact with Daniels' mother, Constance. And arranged to have Daniels' effects sent to his mother. On to the latter half, latter part of the 20th century. Episcopalian Gordon Person served as governor from 1951 to 55, and then in 1979, Bob James, a member of the vestry of Emmanuel Opelika, was elected to his first term as governor. On the morning of his inauguration, Bishop Stow presided at a service of Holy Eucharist in St. John's, with two of James's sons serving as acolytes and other family members reading the lessons. Of course, he served again as governor in 1995 to 99, but then as a Republican. James was a very different kind of Episcopalian than most other Alabama Episcopalians. He signed into law a bill allowing for voluntary prayer in schools, although it was subsequently declared unconstitutional, and his wife, Bobby, was a charismatic who spoke in tongues. It could be said in the last half of the 20th century, the Episcopal Church was suffering an identity crisis. It became a wild place in some ways, and these stresses and strains were bound to have consequences. One consequence was the split at the Church of the Ascension, but another consequence was the construction of Montgomery's Church of the Redeemer. Even though it went dormant for a time, I understand that it has been revived. Wrap this up. To quote the prophet Amos, "I am no prophet nor prophet's son, neither am I a herdsman nor a hewer of sycamore trees like Amos was." As I said at the beginning, the Episcopal Church has traditionally been the church of the plantation aristocracy, the Bourbons, the big mules, the industrialists, but I think this began to change right after World War II. The GI Bill gave access to higher education to large numbers of people who didn't have it otherwise. This resulted in affluence. Some became members of the Episcopal Church, but many did not. So what is the future of the Episcopal Church in Montgomery and Alabama? In his book, The Next Christendom, Philip Jenkins points out that the center of gravity of Christianity is now in the southern hemisphere, not the northern. As this chart shows, 1910, Europe had 66% of the world's Christians. In 2010, only 26%. And the growth of Christianity in Africa has been phenomenal. I suspect that the future of the Episcopal Church is with Christians from the developing world who are coming here. I know from my own perspective as a priest in Las Vegas that our growing edge is in the Latino community. Bishops Cobbs, Wilmer, Beckwith, McDowell, Carpenter, and the rest could not have foreseen what their church would look like in the 21st century, but they built well. And I hope and pray that we'll continue to build on the strong foundation they established. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, we do have some time for a few questions. If anyone has one, just raise your hand. We've got a couple of microphones that we'll share.
Mr. Vaughn.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate your reference to my father and to Christ Redeemer, but I think that the demographics of the Episcopal Church have changed considerably.
Oh, they have.
In the country, have they not? And I wanted to know if you could comment on that.
Well, I don't know what our percentages are right now. I wish I did. I can only speak from my personal experience. As I said, in Las Vegas, rector of the old downtown church in Las Vegas, essentially the St. John's of Las Vegas, Christ Church Las Vegas. And we have about 150 to 200 Anglo worshipers on Sunday, but we have well over 200 Latino worshipers on Sunday, and that's growing. I also know that in the Middle Atlantic states, especially around New York area, churches that were once completely white now are filled with black worshipers from the Caribbean and other parts of the world. So I know that our demographics are changing. This is going to change everything in the Episcopal Church. I sometimes say that in 100 years, the Episcopal Church will not exist. I don't mean it's going out of business. I mean the Episcopal Church as we know it will no longer be recognizable to us because of this change. I'm not going to say it's a good thing or it's a bad thing. I just think it's what's happening. And I need to say this, Julian, I didn't say it because I'm primarily talking about Montgomery. Your father, Julian McPhillips, director of St. Luke's Mountain Brook, was one of the genuine heroes of this diocese. He was one of the few priests who spoke out unambiguously during the civil rights period. I admire him enormously.
Thank you. Thank you. I would point out that Christ Redeemer and I were about half black and half white.
That's great. Well, I rushed through the last couple of pages because I was running out of time, but I was going to give credit to Christ the Redeemer. To my knowledge, it's the first predominantly white church in this diocese to call a black priest to serve. Vernon Jones served as your interim part-time rector, and I think that is very, very significant and admirable. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. They're going to stuff me and mount me after this.
I suppose, is it on? I suppose everybody tells their own stories. Now, St. Paul's Augustus said that that was where the House of Bishops met in the southern, and that they voted to establish the Southern Episcopal Church.
I've never heard that.
Upon the fact that the succession, in fact, lasted.
I know that the first meeting was here in Montgomery. It was kind of a logical place to have it since the Confederate Congress was here when they decided to meet, although it moved right after that. My records show it was in Columbia, South Carolina. I'll double check that. I've never heard about it being in St. Paul's Augusta, but I'll look into that. Thank you for pointing that out. There may have been another meeting of the bishops after the Columbia meeting. Because after all, the Confederate Episcopal Church was in existence for 4 or 5 years, depending on how you count. So there could have been a meeting of the bishops there, but I don't think the organizing meeting was there. I'll find out, though. Thank you. Oh, I'm glad you like it. Thank you.
And I really appreciate you doing that research.
Yes, ma'am. I thoroughly enjoyed doing it. Even it took me 7 years. I was rector of St. Albans in Hoover for much of that time, and I know they got, eventually they stopped asking me, when will it be finished? Because they kept saying 6 months, and then a year later, 6 months, you know. I didn't know.
Okay, well, if there aren't any more questions today, then thank you once again for coming, and thank you once again to our speaker for the wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Sheila.